This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book Trouble. Author, George Oliver Smith. Chapter 1. Tom Lionel, consulting engineer, awoke with a shake of his head. At once, he was out of bed. He consulted first the calendar, and then the clock. The thought struck him funny. He hadn't been drinking, but the idea of looking at a calendar upon awakening might be construed as an admission that he didn't know what time of what day it was. Or mayhap what month. Ding it, he grunted. I've been away again. He dressed by stages. At the trousers department, Tom wandered out into the living room and stood over a chessboard, studying the setup. The opponent had moved the queen to the rook's fourth, menacing his bishop. Tom smiled and moved his knight to his knight's sixth, and checked the opponent's king on the rook's first and the queen simultaneously. He slid the drawer below the table open and removed a little standing sign that said, in red block letters, "Check." Let him try that one, will he? Laughed Tom. The move was basic. In checking the king and menacing the queen simultaneously, Tom had, or would upon the next move, collect himself his opponent's queen with no great loss. At the shirt and necktie stage, Tom Lionel stood teetering on his heels before the bookcase on the right of the fireplace. He took from the case a slim volume and read the title with considerable distaste. Theory of Monomolecular Films in Fission Reaction. By A.G. Rodin, Ph.D., M.M., LL.D. Yipe! Exploded Tom as he opened the book and glanced at the price, $9.50. With ease he prorated the price against the thickness of the volume, and came to the estimate that the book had cost approximately $19 per inch excluding covers. He riffled through the pages and paused here and there to read, but the pages themselves were a good average of 4 lines of text to the rest of the page full of nuclear equations. Tom Lionel snorted. He ran down through one of the arguments and followed it to conclusion. Why can't he get something worth reading? He yawned, putting the book back in its place. Darned impractical stuff. As usual with a man who spends much time in his own company, Tom Lionel talked aloud to himself and occasionally was known to answer himself back. The whole trouble with the entire tribe of physicists, per se, is the fact that once, someone told one of them that he was a theorist, an idealist, and a dealer in the abstract. Now the bunch of them are afraid to do anything practical, because they're afraid if they do, people won't know they're physicists. Physicists are a sort of necessary end product evil. During the breakfast section of Tom's morning duties, Tom read the latest copy of the Proceedings of the IRE with some relish. A paper on the crystallographic generation of microwaves, complete with plainly manipulated differential calculus and engineering data, occupied most of his time. The rest of the time through coffee, he was making marks on the tablecloth with the egg-laden end of his fork and trying to fit the crystallographic generation of microwaves into a problem that made the article most timely, the solution for which he had been seeking for a week. The mail arrived. 3 household bills were filed in the desk to await the first of the month. 2 advertisements were filed into the wastebasket. 1 thick letter addressed to Thomas Lionel, Ph.D., M.M., was taken carefully between thumb and forefinger and deposited in a letter file. Tom then inspected the other letter file and found 2 letters addressed to Tom Lionel, consulting engineer, which he opened and read. 1 was from a concern in Cedar Rapids that wanted some information on a method of induction heating glued joints selectively without waiting for the normal drying time. The other was a letter from a medium-sized town in Illinois pertaining to some difficulty they were having with police radio coverage of that area. Both letters meant money, and Tom Lionel set the first aside while he started to work on the second. From the engineering data supplied by the local engineer, Tom decided that a change in antenna height and a conversion from quarter-wave current fed to a 1 1/4-wave current fed antenna would give the desired coverage. He concluded his letter with 4 pages of calc, 7 diagrams, and as a last measure dropped a photograph of a similar installation in the envelope. He gloated. That would net him a pretty penny. The guy who hung that antenna on top of the water tank thought he was smart, getting all that height. But the roof was metal, and therefore the radiation angle took off from the rooftop as a basis rather than the true ground 100 feet below. The tank top was greater than 3 wavelengths in diameter, and conical to boot. Tom grinned at the maze of mathematics that solved it, and as far as he was concerned, it was solved, for Tom Lionel was a top-flight engineer. He checked on his calendar. Metal for the sonic job was not due for a week yet. A minute casting was still being held up for the foundry's pleasure, and the life test of the bearing jewel for the Watson Instrument Corporation was still on. Good jewel that. No sign of freeze-up or wear-out after 27 million cycles. Theory of monomolecular films be hanged, he snorted. He's the kind of a guy that would try to analyze the brew that Macbeth's three witches were cooking up. And don't ask why. What he objected to most was the other's unconcern at spending money. $9.50 for a book of the most questionable theory, and $9.50 that the other didn't really earn. It was getting worse. The other was really beginning to obtrude.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.